You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Okay, now let's take a look at the U.S. war with Mexico. Now, when discussing this particular war, U.S. historians deliberately distort the people's experiences and they couch the war in sectional rivalry. The war is always written as an extension of the debate over slavery versus free labor that we'll get involved with in the later presentation. There is no attempt, even by the most liberal of historians, by the most liberal of writers, and in this particular case, your textbook, to look at the war in terms of human rights, and to look at the war in terms of its consequences to the people on the both sides of the border. Basically, the war is always presented in U.S. history textbooks as just part of an ordinary process of the United States expanding westward, linking two marketing systems, one going west and one going north. The war results in the California Compromise of 1850. But there are the consequences of the war for Mexico. The war is an object lesson. The war is an episode in a people's history. You see, you need to understand, Mexico lost. Mexicans lost. So in the national character of Americans, Mexicans are losers. That's why they refer to them as Mexicans. You never refer to a Mexican as an American. No, you always refer to a Mexican as a Mexican. Why? Because in the national character, they're not American. They're Mexicans. And as Mexicans, you see, they lost. They lost the war. So you have to understand there is a terrible object lesson for Mexicans in U.S. history. They are losers. And as long as that is part of the process, U.S. historians will never address the consequences of this war in terms of human rights for Mexicans. That's the problem. Mexicans are losers. They lost. Now, the events of the war could not help but encourage people to take a hard look at where they were going and what they were doing. The territory and the people were more concentrated. Mexico is a lot smaller and more compact. Government education and communication becomes easier. And a sense of nationalism is born. Not all societies develop a sense of this. Mexican nationalism isn't created by the war, but it is stimulated by it. Because there is a historical fate. A portion of the nation is to be outside the boundaries of the nation. And this fact is going to have further consequences in Mexican history. Now, over 2 to 3 million of its citizens today live outside Mexico. The xenophobia stimulated by the war prevails in the community. There is a distrust of the Yankee that's formed in the war. It is part of the Mexican experience to this day. The war removes any possibility for Mexico to be a major world power. Mexico, prior to the war, was a very big country. It ranked 4th worldwide in territory. Russia, China, and then the British Empire, and then Mexico. The natural resources, the territory, the increases in population could have made Mexico powerful. But after the war, the Mexican dream of moving north died out. You see, Mexico was likewise following its agrarian ideal by north, by moving north, para el norte. Just as the Americans were moving west, move west, young man, to follow the Jeffersonian ideal, of the human ideal, Mexicans were moving north to follow the human ideal. So when the United States takes over half of Mexico, the Mexican dream now becomes a nightmare. And the Mexican nightmare continues in the United States. All right? So for the United States, the consequences for the U.S. is ensured that the United States would strategically become a world power. The system becomes continental. The oceans become the borders. The natural resources such as minerals and oils were at the nation's disposal. Just to give you an example, it wasn't California gold, but it was Arizona gold. $2 billion in gold has been extracted from Arizona alone. The acquisition of the land stimulated internal tensions that eventually, for the United States, it would lead to civil war. The U.S. acquired a territory that was vital. The legitimacy of its holding is a question that continues to be raised in the scholarly literature. The U.S. acquired a people within it. The U.S. acquired a people with a different sense of history. The U.S. acquired a people with a different culture. The U.S. acquired a people with a different linguistic tradition. This population was growing at the time of the takeover. Of course, this population is growing today, and of course, it scares the racists because the racists think that Mexicans want to take their territory back. But no, Mexicans that are coming across, they are just working, trying to find their economic survival. They're not wanting to take Mexico back. But only those who read history in that manner have this fear, because they know. Why do they have the fear? Because they know that this war that the United States won was an unjust war, and they don't want to face that fact. The U.S. became an aggressor nation. The U.S. became a dominating nation. Now, you can lie to the school children, and you can lie to college students, you can lie to university students, but the politicians knew that the country was blemished. There were clear material consequences for the occupation. Now, in the political process, the tensions increase in the area of foreign policy and human rights. The values and attitudes that were contested back then can be seen argued to this day about what to do with the Mexican. There was a pro-war opinion that expressed itself in very simple arguments. There are altruistic and good reasons for going to war with Mexico. People are induced to support the war because Mexico has to be set straight since it's not honoring an American claim. Mexican diplomats didn't behave properly towards American diplomats. Mexico mistreated its American citizens. This is the popular opinion, the pro-war opinion, the popular opinion that is going to be pushed on American citizens to go ahead and fight in this war. Intellectually, the war would be good for Mexico because she could benefit from American rule. Morally, it is manifest destiny of the U.S. to have this territory, and the president is an agent of God. And of course, the best argument is that Mexico attacked the United States on American soil. So defense of the homeland, defense for national security, was the motive for war. Now, there was an anti-war sentiment that was not as appealing, but it did attract a following. Historians to this day stifled in American textbooks. The anti-war group claimed that the war arguments were not noble. They were not, the war was not a noble act, but it was an attempt by the South to expand its cotton production. They accused President Polk of manipulating the facts and deviously increasing his fortunes and the fortunes of his party members. Western interests were influenced by land developers who wanted ever more chunks of real estate. The U.S. attacked Mexico, not the other way around. So there were many, many different causes for the war, as well as opposition to it. Southern slavery interests were pushing for the war. Southerners feared that war would stop slavery. Others thought that it would increase slavery. But many, many just wanted their share of Mexican lands. Politicians representing the West, especially Jackson and Polk, were committed to supporting the acquisition of more land. So war was logical. It would satisfy Western politicians, promises to large landowners, and more land could be secured. So the commercial, the banking, and the trading interests from the Middle Atlantic and the Northeast wanted to expand as far as China, and California seemed to be an ideal spot to complete the continental system. Manifest destiny. This is particular to North Americans, to Anglo-American nationalism. The American sense of freedom and democracy impel this ideology, which was first formulated by President Monroe in 1820 under a doctrine stating the U.S. would not allow foreign interference in the independence movements of Latin America. The U.S. was making the world safe for democracy. It was known as the Monroe Doctrine. This notion is important because when Texas falsely claims independence and then wishes to annex itself to the United States, it will give moral justification, manifest destiny will give moral justification to something that is really immoral. Now, President Polk was a person who reflected all of these forces. He was the man for the South, the West, and for commerce. God was with Polk, but his vision was broader than any of the forces because he wanted the big pie. He wanted the entire Western Hemisphere, and he certainly brought on the war, and he was successful at that. Well, why not take over the entire Western Hemisphere? So the annexationist fever engulfs Polk, and this vision will influence filibustering activities in Nicaragua and in Sonora, where people will go in and claim the countries on behalf of the United States. There was opposition to the war. The oppositions were of two sorts. People who opposed the war on altruistic and humanitarian grounds, and people who were whose economic interests would be endangered. Now, the altruists were not many. They were characterized by the transcendentalist view. Most altruists were writers and intellectuals. They argued that materialism is wrong and that Mexico and that war, the U.S. war with Mexico, smacked of greed. Some of the altruists went to jail protesting the war. In fact, the most famous of altruists was Thoreau, who wrote a book on resistance to war. And why not on tax resistors? He spent one day in jail, and then his grandmother bailed him out because she couldn't stand the idea of him being incarcerated. The abolitionists were another important group to protest the war. Garrison was the most famous leader and writer to oppose the war because it was immoral. And meanwhile, there were traditional Democrats who opposed the war because it threatened American institutions and democracy. The war would corrupt politicians. War would also maximize the power of the president and the bureaucracy, and that true democracy would be a thing of the past. And finally, there were honest, straight politicians who opposed the war to save America from corruption. John Quincy Adams will give his final speech opposing the war on the floor of Congress, where he would collapse and die, extolling the virtues of an honest republic. And Abraham Lincoln likewise would go on record opposing the war. Now, one side is clearly the aggressor. The other side is the victim. Mexico loses the war and suffers its consequences. Now, how can one look at Mexico's responsibility in the war? Now, U.S. textbooks, especially from Texas, put the blame of the war in Mexico. That's why it is called the Mexican War. Justifications for writing the war in this way include that there was a war spirit in Mexico, that Mexico is responsible because it didn't sell the land when the U.S. made the offer to purchase it, and basically Mexico refused to mediate wrongs against its citizens. Mexico was unjust to the Anglo settlers since the laws didn't give them freedom and the laws discriminated against them. No slavery, adoption of Catholicism. The local governments were to include Anglos and Mexico did not comply. Now, most importantly, American blood was spilled on American soil. This was known as the dispute over ownership of land between the Nueces and the Rio Grande. But Mexican historians, on the other hand, they take a harsh attitude towards their nation. Factionalism and bipartisan conflict contributed to Mexico's demise. Liberals blame conservatives, conservatives blame liberals. The major issue amongst the Mexican elite after the war is figuring out who's responsible for losing. Historians look at the liberals as being responsible for events leading to the war, and they blame conservatives for their ineptness during the war. Mexican historians blame liberals for their policy of colonization that they pursued after the Constitution of 1824 was ratified. The northern territories of Mexico needed development, therefore they created a policy of recruiting settlers for the northern states. And this policy of colonization is partly responsible for the war because it was pursued in the most exposed and most vulnerable frontier area. Instead of opening up California and Sonora, liberals opened up Texas. Liberals believed in a government by federalism, but emphasized local democracy or states' rights over federal rights. And this commitment was good for Mexican nationalists, but it gave voice in state government to foreigners who had no interest in Mexico, hence the question over the Alamo. Mexican historians then blame conservatives, the church, the officer class, and the elites for losing the war. During the war years, historians find it hard to locate within their policies any idealism or altruism. Conservatives put their class interests and their institutional interests ahead of their national interests. And this weakens Mexico's negotiating position with the U.S. Conservatives put all efforts not to fighting the war, but to ousting liberals from office. Conservatives are always willing to bargain with Americans. And so Americans just waited until conservatives gained power. Once conservatives are in, conniving begins. So historians questioned the economic motivation of conservatives as they entered into war with the U.S. There was a question of economic gain. Bankers and investors welcomed war because the loans to the government provided them with fortunes from the interest on the loans. And if payment couldn't be made, they acquired federal land and property. So to summarize, Mexican historians write of the weakness of Mexico's national organization and consciousness. And just by looking at General Santa Anna's career, one can see the precariousness of Mexican nationalism, and perhaps we can get a glimpse of why it continued down this path. Santa Anna, who is going to be president of Mexico several times since the Battle of the Alamo and the loss at Goliad, was not a national leader. He was inept, he was vain, he had no sense of responsibility. Santa Anna saw events strictly in relation to his own fortunes. When the U.S. Army marched on the federal district, DF, the U.S. Army was outnumbered tremendously by all the poor people who lived in the district. In fact, several soldiers wrote that they could have been annihilated if the poor had been armed. But the poor could not defend themselves since the rich fled town with all the arms, leaving the poor defenseless in Mexico City. The Mexican rich in general and Santa Anna in specific feared the poor peoples would revolt against them, not just against the occupying army, but also them as the class. So just understand that Donald Trump came early to Mexico, and Mexico lost half its territory. Okay, thank you.
You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.